raptor in your mind, like what comes to your mind when you hear the word raptor? Because most people get this sort of mental image, you know, the large, scary velociraptors from Jurassic Park. I mean, they have those sharp teeth, big claws, they're scary looking, and, you know, they're just raptors, powerful. Well, first of all, real velociraptors are actually more this size. They're pretty small. And I'm actually not here to talk about extinct velociraptors. Turns out they're actually living raptors in our world today, and they're actually called birds of prey. And some of them are obviously very terrifying. So birds of prey, also called raptors, are descendants of dinosaurs. So basically they're modern day velociraptors. And you can see the resemblance there a bit. And so humans often look at birds of prey and they're like awestruck by their powerful features because they have those big talons, big feet, and beaks, and they have feathers as well. And what if I told you there was a way to work one-on-one with one of these amazing velociraptors? Turns out there is. So through the sport of falconry, there's actually a trusting relationship that's able to be formed between the human and the bird. And so I'm going to talk about some of the most effective training methods that are used in falconry and my experience training bird prey as well. So you're all probably wondering, Grace, why would I want to form a relationship with a bird of prey? Well, regardless if you're a bird nerd like me or not, you have to admit that birds are very unique, and so they have some very fascinating traits, like I've explained before. So they have feathers, and they also have some flight capabilities. And so another thing is wild birds can also be very difficult to observe. So by working hands-on with them in falconry, you're able to get these behaviors that you wouldn't normally see when observing them in the wild. And so working with these birds and their behaviors, you can get an increased knowledge about what they're like, and that could also be applied to other animal birds possibly as well. So in order to understand these training techniques, first you need some background information about falconry. And so I'm just going to kind of give you the gist of what falconry is about and what you do in it. So first of all, what is falconry? So falconry is a sport of hunting with falcons or other birds of prey and the training and keeping of such birds, according to Oxford Dictionary. We have Lauren McGough, she's an eagle huntress, she's really cool. But basically you just, you train birds of prey and you hunt with them. So falconry actually dates back thousands of years to the medieval times. And in the medieval times, it's actually a part of social status. So depending on like your rank in society, you could own different kinds of birds. So kings could only hunt with gerfalcons, it's that white bird up there. Gerfalcons are the largest birds, the largest falcons in the world. Princes could hunt with female peregrine falcons, which are still large birds, it's that second picture there. And then servants could hunt with common kestrels, which are still, they're pretty small falcons, it's that bottom picture there. So basically, like, those birds take different kinds of prey sizes. So depending on your rank in society, you could hunt with different kinds of birds. And then working with falcons and other birds of prey requires special equipment. So you know how when you work with horses, you need saddles and reins and stuff like that. Well, working with falcons and other birds of prey requires your own set of equipment and for you and the bird. So I'll get some pictures in a second, but the first thing is called mews. So it's basically like an aviary for the birds. That's where the falconers keep the birds. So there are two main kinds of mews. So first are the indoor mews, where the birds just kind of stay there in the falconry off season when they're not being flown. And that's also where they molt their feathers every year, which they just shed them. And then there are the outdoor mews, where usually they'll stay during the day if they're, just kind of chilling, if the weather's nice. And that's just an indoor mew perch, because we need perching spaces for birds. Another piece of equipment that's very important is the glove. Because raptors are modern-day velociraptors, they have some crazy talons, so you have to be able to protect yourself from those sharp tools. So with this, there are different kinds of gloves. So mine is an elk leather, like an elk hide leather glove right here. And then there are also different kinds of gloves, like kangaroo leather and sometimes cow hide. But basically, you just need a glove because that's just the logical thing to do with working with birds of prey. Enjoy that there. And then falcons, they have special things on their legs called jesses. So jesses are made up of three main parts, and all together, they make up the jesses. So the first thing is the anklets. Those go around the bird's ankles like a bracelet. And then the second part to jesses are the jesses, which go through a hole in the anklets. Those are kind of like leather straps that make sure birds can be tethered and handled. And then to kind of tie it all together is a swivel and leash. So it's like, it brings it all together and makes so the falconer can handle the bird so they can stay on the glove. One of the most important pieces of equipment is a giant hood. You can actually see one back there, which a lot of you probably saw when I came in the room. But it's basically like a transportation box for the birds, and birds, they're so visually inclined that when they go into a giant hood in that dark space, they will almost immediately calm down because they don't need to see anything. And so some birds, some falconers will actually put their birds in there at night to sleep. And so giant hoods are very important. And then I would say this is probably one of the most important pieces of equipment as well. It's called a scale. And so scales are used to weigh birds. Most of the time today, because falconers need to do this in order to basically get their birds' motivation levels for the day. And I'll go more in depth about that later. So now that I've told you about, you know, the equipment stuff, I'm going to tell you about the actual bird that I worked with. So this is Zeke. He is a deer falcon, a peregrine falcon hybrid, and he is captive bred. And I mean, if Zeke knew he was here, he'd probably feel called out, but he's not. But Zeke the falcon is also very noisy at times. So yeah, he makes pretty loud noises. But with Zeke the falcon, I had to train him somehow. So I'm gonna kind of go into those techniques that I used to train him. So you'll basically see Zeke go through a behavioral metamorphosis in a way, because he goes from being crazy wild, not wanting to do anything with people, to being a pretty tamed down bird and being willing to work with people. So the first technique I use is called weight management. And like I mentioned earlier, scales are important in falconry because you can weigh the birds. And the reason for that is to gauge their motivation level. And so since falcons are predators, they're most focused on getting the next meal. And so by weighing Zeke every day, you can measure their motivation level and how much food they're willing to work for. So in this first video, this is when I first took him out of the mew to start the training process, and he was not very happy. He was kind of crazy. Hold on, was that all there? So he's got some pretty wild behavior there, and that's because he weighed around 940 grams, which, believe it or not, is actually really heavy for him. Because his typical weight range is around 640 to 740 grams. So the second video, you kind of see him, he sort of started to calm down. He actually sat on my glove, but he was still...
Oh, there is a good rouse. Okay. That's good. He's starting to relax a little bit. That's good.
But he was still panting. And so, like, after some time, he started to calm down, but these were most prominent when he weighed around 940 grams. These things are actual records. So falconry, you keep weight records with your birds. You write down their weights every single day. So that top left is when he first came out of me, he weighed 940 grams. And then the bottom one is after about, 3 weeks on April 5th. April 5th is that top left one. And after about 3 weeks of reducing his weight carefully to get to that proper weight range, that was on April 16th, he weighed around 868 grams. And then this one is about 2 weeks after that, on about May 1st, he weighed around 778 grams. And I will show you in a second how his weight is directly affected by, his behavior is directly affected by his weight. So the next training technique is called manning. And weight management and manning go hand in hand. So manning is basically getting the bird used to situations it would often find uncomfortable. Similar to how people, they get nervous before they do stuff, like they do my capstone. And it's not as bad as they thought. So, back when Zeke was really stressed, this is when he was first out of the mew, 940 grams. And you can tell he's really stressed. You can see that second video there. He decides to fly off the rug. So he didn't want anything to do with me because he didn't recognize me as a food source yet. But you will see in that first video another behavior that is very stressed. He's panting, and birds pant similar to dogs. They'll have their mouths open. And they'll be kind of, their wings are droopy, and he's just not really having it. But these behaviors, like I said, are most prominent when you weigh around 940 grams. So this next kind of phase is I had to get him used to me. So I would sit with him for hours on end, just get him used to being around people and the everyday commotion of, life. And so in that middle video, he's still a lot happier to be on his own perch than he is on my fist. And does not like to still be around people.
All right, let him go. There's the bird, and there's the doctor. Exhausted.
Yeah, it is indeed exhausting. But in that second video, you can kind of see his alert behavior. So he's kind of, sitting straight up, looking around. He's like, I might fly off the glove at any time, but he's just kind kind of trying to get used to surroundings. And so these overall alert but slightly calmer demeanors were around 868 grams, so he was a little bit more reduced. So this is where the fun part of falconry comes in, is when the birds start exhibiting positive behaviors after weeks of manning. So when Zeke was almost completely manned, he started doing these cute little behaviors. So the first video is him rousing his feathers, which basically he shakes its feathers and then just re-raises them. And birds will only do that when they feel content and they feel happy. And so that's a sure sign that he was feeling comfortable in the glove. That second picture, yes, he actually fell asleep on the glove. And so that was a very good behavior that I wanted to see, because that told me that he knew he could make himself vulnerable around me. And so then you'll see in that middle picture in the top right, it's a little bit hard to see, but he's standing on one foot there, and you can tell he's content there because birds stand on one foot when they're actually happy. That's kind of why flamingos do it sometimes too. And so that was a huge sign of interest to me as well, because he's standing on one foot. And then that bottom right picture right there, he's just kind of tilting his head like, what's that? Because I was taking a picture of him with my phone, and he was curious. So Zeke was exhibiting curious and content and positive behaviors through the last stage of manning. And this is when he weighed around 778 grams. So now you're probably wondering, how did Zeke get to this point to where he could exhibit these behaviors just by doing them over and over and getting used to them? Well, the answer to that is something called positive reinforcement. So like I mentioned earlier, raptors are very food motivated. And so that means every time Zeke would do a behavior that I wanted him to, I would give him a tasty treat. And so that would motivate him to want to do more of that behavior. So in this video, we can see he will jump to my fist because he knows he'll get food if he does that. So he jumped up because he knew that he would get the food reward. And so positive reinforcement is directly tied into weight management. So by monitoring Zeke's weight, you can tell exactly how much food was necessary to give him. And so that would motivate him to want to do the behavior more often in the future. And so you'd get results like that. And so these training methods, I mean, they have some sort of importance, right? Because falconry can be used to inspire others as well. And so by implementing these training methods into falconry programs, and, like, people use these around the world in zoos and in education centers so they can have experience with birds. So I just like to explain these three pictures on the top real fast. So the first one over there is my friend Kurt. He does the Rise Raptor Project, which is basically a nonprofit organization. And he's reached thousands of people with his bird programs, and actually worked with some of his birds this summer. And then that middle picture is where I actually first heard about falconry when I was 11 years old. That was at the Buffalo Bill Museum up there at their raptor program. I'm sure a lot of you have probably seen that. And then that last picture, it was really cool. That was at Tracy Aviary in Utah when I got to hold an endangered Okamama falcon at a bird show. But basically, the whole reason these experiences were possible was because of these training techniques in falconry, the careful and precise execution of weight management, and positive reinforcement training. So in conclusion, falconry is something that should be continued forever so we can keep inspiring future generations. And